let us begin with prayer. Lord, we do thank you for this day and time to gather again to hear your word, to learn about your church, your people. And it's our church, it's our history, it spreads all the way through your word to the beginning. You have had a faithful hand over your church, and we thank you for such guidance. At times we wonder why it's going in certain directions, but the trust is there that one day that plan will be so known, so revealed, and we will see what you have done to bring us to completion, to bring us to you again. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, this is the third week of class. So we did an intro. We're going to do something today, but what was that something that was last week, if you can remember, all the way back?
Only Scripture.
Only Scripture. Yeah, sola Scriptura is the fancy way to say that. What does that mean, and what doesn't that mean? We talked a little bit about both.
If you have a question, go back to the Bible and get the answer out of that.
Okay.
That's the final word.
Yeah, so.
If you have something to test it with the Bible.
Scripture.
Yeah. Back to the Bible. That was the command. If you want to know what's true, what is authoritative for the church, it's not to the councils or to the leadership, it's to the Bible. It's not that we don't have any of those other things that we can listen to, but all of those things are under Scripture, what the Bible has to say. That's a big part of the Reformation is this idea to go back to sources. Yeah.
That's how we keep the preachers under control.
Keep them honest, right?
Where do you learn that, Rachel?
I don't think controlling the preachers is the hard way. Thank you.
So we're gonna move on today. Why should be in the back row?
That's right. Next to Mark.
To keep with the fancy descriptions, this is sola fide, faith alone. But before we get there, just to make sure we're all on the same page, people have been able to come at different times to sermons or classes. There's just this sense before the Reformation that you just needed something more. You needed to do something extra, something additional to be good enough. So, you know, even if you think you're a pretty good Christian, there still is going to be some punishment for you after you die in purgatory. We talked about purgatory a lot in the Bible study last week. It's not what the Reformation would teach, but that was the idea then. Even if you do all those things you're supposed to do according to the church in the 1500s, even if you do all of them as best you can, that still wasn't enough. You got to do something even as you're dead. Even in the grave, you're expected to do something or to have something done to you. Something must be done in this life or in the afterlife to be right with God, to be saved. And so it's not just faith, fide, it's something alongside it. So what could we fit into that equation, faith plus something? Is there anything that we can think of that would be fitting in the blank?
You mean what they thought or really is?
Are you asking what the Catholic Church would have pretty much said?
How about just what anybody
works?
Like works. Okay, that's something we do. Alright, faith plus works, that equals
salvation.
At least something more like salvation. There still is, again, maybe some punishment afterwards. What other things do people put in next to faith?
Are you asking now or
anytime? Things that even you think that you are. Sometimes we do things without really acknowledging that we're doing it. It's kind of subconsciously we put these things alongside of faith. Faith and then I do this. Faith and I show up to church.
Some kind of activity.
Come to Sunday school, right?
Activity.
Some kind of activity. Yeah.
Well, for some types.
Yeah, works and activity. Just even say something for some people, it's attendance.
And awareness.
Yeah. Fellowship.
Okay, fellowship.
Sin.
Sin. What would be the
sin? Yeah, well, that's what the cycle is. Faith plus sin equals salvation, because you're always going through the cycle. I mean, I'm not saying that that's sin is what your goal is.
Yeah. Make for an interesting sermon, right?
Yeah.
I got the key for you guys. Bring up a big, like, Price is Right reel, wheel. Go through the seven deadly ones. There's your... Faith plus anything, that was some of the realization that was going on in the Reformation of if faith in Christ is so good and so sufficient, what does it say if I put anything alongside of it as a necessity, as something that must be done? Again, how did Luther break free from that mindset of a faith plus works? This is the question that's going to be asked most every week. I hit it in the sermon as well. So at the end of October, if you don't answer this one right, then you're not listening, or I'm just not doing my job. But
doesn't Paul say faith plus hope plus love? Or
he says faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love.
Right.
Okay.
Well, if you're new at faith, wouldn't you want to study and find out more?
Yeah, you do. You do want to do other things. And we'll get to that, especially about two-thirds of the way through the class. So it's not that we think of faith as just sitting on our hands and doing nothing, but in terms of what does faith accomplish, and do we have to do anything else for it to do its job? For trust, well, I'm getting ahead of myself.
Prayer wouldn't hurt.
Yeah, I mean, prayer, there are plenty of things in the life of the Christian. All right, so you're talking about Paul, but just the scripture is where people go. Here was the way it was, and then Luther and other reformers were able to see it differently because they went back to the Bible. There's a good reason that we start with sola scriptura, because it's not that everything else is based on the Bible as though the Bible is more important than Jesus, but that's where we look to see Jesus, to see what he's done. So let's go through some scriptures. I think that's what I've got next. Can somebody read that loudly?
But if it is by grace, it is no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace.
All right, so there was this focus on works. And then people like Luther started to read in the Bible and came to very different conclusions of this faith plus works thing. So works, what do we do with it? What's it say here about the relationship that works have to the work of God?
Works not going to save
you. Okay. We're pushing a little bit into some of the by grace alone week, but these things, they fit together. When we look at them in separate weeks as five solas, but they really tie in nicely together. The idea of grace, by definition, means what in regards to works?
You do it, but you don't do it for the same reasons.
Yeah, and some of it has to do with, I'll try to write this big and diagonal because, sorry. It has to do with the purpose. Do we still do works as Christians?
Yeah.
Well, yes. What were they understood to do in the 1400s, in the early 1500s before the Reformation? What did they do? They get you to heaven, or they get you out of purgatory. They get you saved. They make you forgiven. Our works. And that's an important thing, too. Just so we're not confused, our works. And the purpose of them was to gain favor of God. right with God. And so we still can do works, but when we see what grace is, it says, by definition, grace would not be grace if we even let a sliver of work make its way in to the understanding that this is what saves me. So if we say that God's grace brings me all the way from here to within striking distance of God, and then I just got to do these works to finish it, well then, is that actually grace? Paul says, no, that's not grace. God doesn't come down to us in Jesus to just give us a leg up. Like, all right, guys, I think this should do it. You should be able to put yourself over the wall now. You know, I'm going to lower a ladder just low enough that if you reach up, you got it. He says, no, it's not that God didn't just help us. He didn't just make things possible. Grace means it's not our work at all. In response, we can do those things, and we'll look there.
I kind of feel like it's when you're offered that free night stay in a resort. They're like, oh, but you have to come on this hour long tour and let us give you the sales pitch first. Like, then it's not free because you have to do this thing to do it.
Grace is free. We don't. Whenever somebody tells you something is free, what are your immediate reactions? Hair goes up on the back of your neck, spidey sense, whatever you want to call it. I perhaps have missed out on things in life because I just don't believe people when they tell me it's free. I'm like, no. But no, really, this one, sorry, I'm just not interested because I assume that there's always a string attached. I think it's part of how we're made. We really do think that we earn, we work, and then we receive. And so if something is out there that is a free gift, we start to imagine strings onto it. Okay, it's a free gift of God as long as I do this. And the church at the time was happy to come in and supply what those strings were. And so if it's grace, it's not work. Work's got to be taken out of that equation. Here's another passage. Somebody want to read that?
I do not nullify the grace of God. For if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose.
This isn't saying something entirely different, but it's coming at it from a different place. So to nullify the grace of God would mean, it's like the big stamp that you put on a check. Void. He's not voiding the grace of God. And then he's saying, because
who is he?
I'm sorry. Galatians is written by Paul. So Paul's writing this. He just makes the point, again, righteousness, being right with God, salvation, this idea. If it were through the law, and the law here, again, is a representation of our work, then Christ died for no purpose. It's a pretty big claim to say, if we understand that works are required, then why did Jesus even die? Let me erase some of this mess of stuff. A lot of times we think of God on a mountaintop. Okay, or actually, let's be more aware of our context, right? So we'll have. That's a mountain. That's a mountain to lessen people, right? We just take the top right off. If God is up there, we think of all these different paths to ascend to God. And what Paul here and other places are saying, that if you think that grace is one thing that we can do to get to God, but you think that there's also works? If we could become righteous, right with God, have perfect fellowship with Him, if we could be right with God by our works, why in the world would grace, which came through Jesus dying on a cross, why would God also provide that way? if there were options before God, it says I can bring people to me by these works, or in God the Son, God Himself will become incarnate and suffer true pain and suffering and death on a cross for us. Why would He do both of those things? Why would Christ ever die if there were any other way? Like, if you could help your friend out who needed something, it's like, I could give you my kidney, or there's a pill that you could take. You'll have to take it every day the rest of your life. Which option are you going to take? I will pay for those pills, right? I want my kidneys. If there was an easy way and a hard way, when do we choose, if all other things are equal, what do we choose? We go with the easy way. I don't walk here, I drive here. You know, I could do both of them, but the car being an option, I'm going to take it. And so Paul is just trying to say, if we can be saved by grace, don't think that works is even a possibility, because otherwise, Jesus was just unnecessary. Jesus was superfluous. He was, I don't know, some bizarre bonus scheme that God came up with. Does that make a little bit of sense?
Did Paul also say that if we do this on our own for our own works, then we have a bigger chance of boasting about what I did and how I'm doing, and then again that takes our vision off of Jesus.
And that's a big one of these themes of the Reformation as well, is my focus on me, and if it is, it's on my work, and then if it's on my work, then it's going to lead to my boasting. Or is my focus on Christ and what He has done? And if that's the case, whatever boasting we have is going to be to what He did. So work is hopefully eliminated from any sort of equation that makes us right with God. And so it was faith plus nothing. It's faith alone, faith in Christ alone, that saves us. So here are a couple of quotes. Martin Luther is the guy up here. In the PBS show, we've seen he had a little, looked like a halo of hair almost, which is kind of a funny thing for a church person to have. Not a popular haircut anymore. To intentionally shave the middle of your head. People do the opposite. We try to.
He's
got to bring it right across the forehead. So this is him with a bit more hair. Luther says, justification, and this is being made just, being made right with God, by faith alone, not works. Faith, sola fide, is a big reaction against the push to do works. Justification by faith alone is the doctrine on which the church or individual stands or falls. Is this an important issue for Luther? He's saying, if you get this wrong, then what? You've got it all wrong. This is one of those, I'm trying to think of an illustration on the fly. There's a reason that people typically start with the edges on a puzzle, because you've got something that you can, that's something firm, something to base the rest of that work off of. Well, if you don't understand that it is faith alone and not works, everything else that you start to understand about God is going to be in the wrong place, the wrong emphasis, the wrong understanding. This is the thing to then kind of unlock the rest. John Calvin says, justification by faith alone is the hinge of the Reformation. What does that mean? What might it mean?
That means you're
sheltering
from God.
What?
What opens or shuts them.
Okay, that's a hinge. Yeah. It's that. It's so important to get some of these things right. The cornerstone is so important for the rest of the building. The hinge, all these things turn on it. It's that center point from which the rest of it flows.
Yeah, this kind of, what Martin Luther says, it's kind of brings a point. The great mystery in my mind is the last part where which the church or individual stands or falls. So, I mean, faith and hope are a gift from God.
Yeah.
But then, so an individual or institution that doesn't, let's just go back to an individual doesn't have faith and hasn't been blessed by God with that spirit or that ability to have faith. So there seems like there's a mystery of, it almost stands, you know, like they're saying the church and the individual is responsible for standing or falling based on this particular spiritual understanding, which you may or may not have, depending on whether God's given you the faith.
Yeah, and we'll, I think grace comes next week, and we'll look again about, you know, where initiative even exists and what is that the entirety of God's work. Again, Luther's a guy who was a teacher in the church. And so if you think of Luther before this understanding, he was within the church, but he was constantly down, you know, fallen in despair and in doubt and worry. And how can I stand before God if I think it's up to me to be good enough by my own works? And so I think that's some of the idea is faith and trust, and we're going to look at this in a second. Faith is trust. And with trust in Christ, we can stand before God. And we can get some of those questions as well, of, you know, where does this gift of faith come from? Because it's again, we don't want to boast that
right.
I figured it out.
Right.
And, you know, we can get into the trap of then making belief or doctrine a work in and of itself.
Yeah, it almost becomes a tightrope when you walk in.
Well, he was actually, I mean, one of the things that started, if you look at the video, is accurate, is he was all talking about the church taking indulgences and all the different stations people went through to give them money.
Yeah.
When he said faith is all you need, not that that's not the idea we had, but I'm saying, so if he came from it from that way, that's why he was saying it's faith alone. You don't have to go along into your pockets. And
right, yeah. I agree with you there. Yeah, I think,
Well, I think, too, though, God built a little vacuum in you that can only be filled by him. And Luther could not fill that vacuum. And as in the movie, when he suddenly realized it, he just jumped for joy, said, wonderful, I found it. I know what it is, because that vacuum that's in there, everybody.
When you first said vacuum, I was thinking like,
you're
talking about a space.
Yeah,
there are all sorts of things that we think we can find satisfaction in, or we think that will make us whole. And none of those things can do it. Yeah, Richard.
I got a question about the internet. Would you have to have faith before you can do the works? Does the Bible say you're judged by your deeds in heaven on the judgment day?
So, in terms of can we do works without faith? I mean, people do good things on this earth. People that inside the church, outside the church. And there are some places, and we can look into that as well with this next week. I'll make a note to myself to make sure we hit on that. Let me do that.
All of that said, people say that was a good man. He's going to have a lot of good men. Don't do it that.
Hey, Case, something that's coming up in 1 Corinthians this week, we're studying in community Bible study.
Yeah.
And it talks about building on the foundation of Jesus Christ. And again, I think that's that faith alone. Like, it's faith alone in Jesus Christ is what is necessary. But then he talks about people building with gold or silver or precious stones, meaning building with good stuff, good deeds, and or building with wood or hay or straw. And that, you know, those who build, you know, worthwhile things, it says they'll receive a reward. But those who don't, like, if they're still on the foundation, they will be saved, but they will suffer loss, it says. Whatever that means, I think it's saying that there's something, you know, our works are good, like they're pleasing to God, they glorify God, they're lasting, but what matters is that foundation, that faith and trust.
Yeah, so we're putting forth five things that they believed And there are lots of books written on this stuff, and there are lots of other beliefs that people have that fill my shells. And we're called to have conviction and to believe what we believe with reason. But it doesn't mean that just because there's a system out there, that there still isn't some mystery. And there certainly is. With Sola Scriptura, one of the things we said that it means, what it doesn't mean, is that the Bible doesn't say every single thing. God is still God, and we are not. But it's sufficient. And so, sola fide, it at least is meaning that it's not our works that save us. And they could never be our works that save us. But I like to say faith is in trust. So sola scriptura was not popes or councils, tradition, not tradition. Sola fide, in the back of that, is not works. And again, they're not trying to say, we've got the answer, now we have the power. This is supposed to be a freeing thing. To tell this is centered in Europe at the time before it spreads elsewhere. But to tell a European population who feels under the thumb of people who have, we own salvation almost, to say, it's not that. The trust isn't in, where can we put trust? We can put it in the church, and the popes, and priests. We can put trust in one another as though they can provide for us. But it's trust in Jesus. And it's not our works, it's in his works. What are you going to say, Harvey?
I think right now, as we're talking about works, we are having these hurricanes and earthquakes, and all we're talking about is the neighbors helping neighbors and everything else.
Yeah.
So what have you got, non-Christians doing good works? I mean, how's this all separated out when you say works? I think it's difficult to say by man's judgment whether you're saved or not, because a lot of these people are sacrificing things, and I'm sure they're not all Christians.
Sure. Well, that's the thing.
And that's a huge test at this time.
There are so many images that get built up, even from within the church, not 500 years ago, but from the church now, as though, pick your poison. I mean, it really is poisonous, this idea. I've heard images of, those filing cabinets that have those drawers that come out beyond what you would ever expect them to do? That, we've all got a drawer that God can pull out, and it's full, it's like our permanent record, that kind of thing. And he can flip through and see what we've done, and then start putting them one thing on one side of the scale. And this goes back, you can find hieroglyphics of a scale, hieroglyphics being in Egypt. And on one side would be your works, I mean really your life, all you've done. And on the other side, not what you'd hope when you're trying to do it. That's a feather. The idea being, was your life so pure? Was your life good enough? And this, I mean, really, that idea of our works making us good, our works coming into the conversation to say, well, that person helped out after Hurricane Harvey, this person gave this many millions of dollars, this person was really nice, all of that is really at the heart of every religion in terms of, here's a system that when you follow these prescribed steps, it will lead you to a good reward. I mean, that's like everything. That's even in our business lives or our personal lives. We think, if I pull this book off the shelf that says 10 steps, I've got a system, I follow it, and my works will be rewarded. This religion in this part of the world, this part, it's you meditate hard enough and you can be freed of this whatever, you do these pillars and then you're going to be rewarded. You do this and then you get. That's everything. I mean, we could call it karma. You get what you deserve. And the idea is this huge break from that the Reformation wanted to reclaim. They didn't come up with it. They went back to Scripture to say, no, if there's any work, it's going to be that we trust in the work of Jesus. And so we trust. So sola fide is trust Jesus' work alone. Let me push on to this next
just one comment
passage.
It seems like our biggest challenge as Christians is just being able to recognize a gift or understand what a true gift is and what grace is. Yeah, we're being accepted.
Yeah.
Because against our human nature.
I mean, deep down in many ways, we want that.
Right, yeah. That other is much more understandable.
You can control that. I want the love of God to be a merit badge that I can wear.
Yeah.
That I've done enough. That's part of what we want. It's how we die. Yeah. But that's again the good news, the joy of the Christian faith is it's not that we're not called to do anything. It's not that there isn't sacrifice or pain. The way of a disciple of Christ is the cross, he says. But throughout all of it, it's never under this magnifying glass of saying, are you following Jesus enough that when you get to the end, you get your reward? It's not that. It's already been paid. All right, let me look at this passage. In my notes I say we could never hit the full depth and beauty of this passage if we spent days on it, and we have 10 minutes. Actually, we've got less than that because I want to hit one other thing. Somebody want to read that?
Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith.
All right, this is Paul again writing to the church in Philippi, in Philippians. What's he have to say?
I haven't gained anything on my own, and if I've tried, it's garbage.
He sees this idea of being in Christ as being of such worth that we always compare stuff. You know, we're happy with what we have until we see something else that somebody else has, right? We do that relative thing. But he says now, seeing what Christ has done, everything else is just fades away. It's just nothing. And it's not my own work. Other places, Paul does talk about how if you're going to judge by works, I wasn't so bad. You know, I had quite the resume. But he realizes even with all those things that I have done, it still was nothing. Some people will describe the things that Christ has done for us, the righteousness that we receive. This is borderline fancy terminology, but it's a neat picture. He calls it alien righteousness. Alien means, doesn't necessarily mean, you know, a gray person with big eyes or something. It is so not my own. It is foreign. It is alien. His righteousness is not my righteousness, but I get to have it. All the things that he's done, it's for me. You know, there are things that people do sacrifice for and give things up. People in the Middle Ages. I don't want to paint this picture as though no one has sincerity in their belief or their teaching. People gave up a lot. To go on a crusade when it was offered, you go on this crusade for the church, and you'll get your and all of these indulgences, all of that punishment will be wiped away. It wasn't an easy thing for people to leave from France. But they had to raise money. They had to sell everything to travel across. And they thought that they're defending Jerusalem from people who were attacking it. People made real sacrifices. But they thought they were doing it because they had to. Or that they were going to get something in return. It wasn't this thing of being almost smitten with Christ. And that's Paul. So taken with the love of Christ that he would do it just because, as a response to it. Some of the pushback from talking about faith alone and not works is this idea that we just are abusing the system. It's cheap grace that doesn't really mean anything. You just, you know, I'll do what I want to on Saturday because on Sunday I'll come back and it's all forgiven. I mean, it is forgiven. People will look at James chapter 2. All right, I see faith, I see works, but I'll take the faith that has works because faith alone, that's the buzzword of the Reformation. Faith alone is dead. He says, if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in food, one of you says to them, go in peace, be warm and filled, without giving them the things that they need for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, so also sola fide, if it does not have works, is dead. What do we do with a passage like that? With the Reformation making such a stink about this, you know? Who are you to say faith alone, going back to the sources, says faith alone is dead?
Once again, I just don't think it has to do with the idea that you accept Christ and you're done.
Sure.
But you don't have to empty your pockets. You don't have to go on and say, but I guess you do need to listen to what you're supposed to do.
Yeah.
And,
okay.
And what is that? You can call it works if you want. I mean, the word is whatever you want it to be. But, I mean, what I go back to the great commandment that I can never remember. You know, we're supposed to love everybody, right? I mean, and help people. We're supposed to do that, not to get into heaven.
Yeah, and it is a commandment.
Christ first loved us.
Yeah, it's a commandment. So we are to do it. Yeah.
What was the big push? What would Jesus do?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think if you think of that, you're thinking of him and you're going to do works if you do what you think he would do in that situation.
Yeah, and all right, I like Sunday school. I like to teach Sunday school. But then if you start going to seminary classes, the word Sunday school, or if you're around people who think that they're really smart, they'll be like, well, that's a Sunday school answer. And as somebody who likes to teach Sunday school, I take offense to this thing. You know, oh, it's a Sunday school answer, therefore it's simplistic and bad. You know, what would Jesus do? It's a little bit of a bad rap. If it leads people to think legalism and works, righteousness, and that's not good, but we're trying to be in everything we do, guided by Jesus. Same thing, people have told me as well, and they know I'm a preacher. They're like, oh, sorry, I'm kind of preaching right now. Like, you said that because by that you meant you were communicating poorly and meanly and without love and a lot. I thought that sentence would be okay. Long-winded, right? I think in James, I think the idea is he is combating, going against sort of a caricature of faith. We recite words together. We did the Apostles' Creed 2 Sundays ago. We've been doing these questions at the end of what do we believe from the Reformation. And that's not faith. I mean, what we say we should believe, that's good. But faith is not showing up in some place and rattling off words. And I think what James is talking about is a faith that begins and ends with just saying something. And I think what James is trying to say is, I'll go on your terms. Let's define faith as just saying something. Well, that faith is dead because it's not, it's just words. And that's why I like, two slides back, that's why I like the idea of trust. Because trust is something that is demonstrated. It's something that drives us. And it's not just we say something, it's that it does lead us to it. But if you really like these Reformation things that we've read at the end of the service, let's be friends, first off, because we like those things too. But the structure of them is even really good. So one of them, it starts with what our condition is, the sin that we have, then what God has done for us in Jesus through grace, and then it talks about the Ten Commandments. And the ordering of that is really intentional, because it's not, here are the Ten Commandments, or here's our sin, here are the Ten Commandments, and then here's the thing that God does for us. We don't go through these commandments in order to get there. The Ten Commandments, the greatest commandment, all those things that we do, it's all response. It doesn't save us, it doesn't make us more loved or less loved by God. It's all response to what he has already done. It's 43. I can say perhaps one more thing. Briefly. The world that they lived in was very stratified. And even within the church, who gave this much? Who did these things? Who are you? Are you the priest? Are you the cardinal? Are you the pope? And you were holier than thou in that system. We're going to hit on this a little bit in the sermon. And it made sense in that system because it did depend upon what you did. What you do made you, I mean, I don't think this is what they're saying out in the front, it was behind it. What you do made you better. And if you go to faith alone, that topples the whole system. Why would the Pope be better than you if it's not what the Pope does that makes them right with God? Why would this so-called saint be any better than you in the eyes of God if it's not about their work? And you are, I mean, this is why it's exciting to teach this stuff. I know it's history and I know it's doctrine and these things can sound less than fun, but it's exciting to teach it because if you hear it and understand it and let it just kind of soak in, the idea of faith alone, not my works, but it's what Christ has done, it means that you are loved as much as any other child of God. Whether you're doing well that day or that year or not, whether you paid your tithe or you didn't. And that's good news. I think that's good news that when the reformers are finding it out, it's what they're eager to share. This isn't just something that's gonna stay in those academic circles. This is, we gotta let people know this stuff. Because it transformed the nations. It transformed that country, the idea that person's no better than me. Because we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It's all about what Christ has done for us. Next week, we're going to look at grace. And again, these things flow together. The fact that we look to Scripture, and that's where we find the idea that it's not me, it's just Jesus, it's faith in him, and this is an act of grace. I don't deserve this. So Christ alone is the one who does it, and it's all for God's glory. Those are the five things, but they work together. So we'll hit on that next week, and anything else? I look to my wife, who things fall out of my brain, I hope she catches them. You got nothing, okay. That's right, I've been gone. Let's close in prayer. Lord, we are to love you with our minds. We sometimes forget those other parts, the idea that we're to love you with our hearts and our souls, sure, but with our mind as well, because when we can better understand you, it doesn't make us more loved, it doesn't make us saved if we get everything just right. But when we can understand just a little bit of the depths of your love, I think we are just wowed. The more we learn, the bigger you are, the more I can see, the greater the sacrifice of Christ. And so, God, we do thank you for such an ability to do that here in the mornings. And we thank you for the gift of your word that can teach us every time we turn to it. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.